We all know building stateful apps on a serverless architecture can be challenging. Just last week, I made this tweet to ask how you all deal with managing state on your serverless apps. And guess what? Out of the 600 people that saw it, I got an amazing zero response. And this goes to show that building stateful serverless apps is quite difficult. I've seen people connect to databases from their serverless functions to store state, but that comes at the cost of the connection latency to the database on every request. And folks have tried to use faster caches, but you still have that connection overhead. And there's just no way for you to store in-memory state like classes in any database. Also, I know people who've been like, screw databases, we're just going to save state on client, and they've used the browser's cookie storage to save state. Of course, this method also has its own drawbacks. For instance, if a user accesses your app from a new device, all of the previous state is automatically gone. So there hasn't been a good solution to store state in serverless apps, at least not until now. I'm pleased to introduce Durable Objects, a powerful API that enables you build stateful serverless apps. Now, what are Durable Objects? Here's a 5-second crash course, and I promise we'll go deeper into it later on in the series. A Durable Object is a long-lived JavaScript class that is not only stateful, but can persist state across restarts. In other words, it's a stateful object for your worker application. And let's switch over to my screen so that I can show you what a durable object looks like. So here's what a durable object looks like. As you can see, it extends the base durable object class, and everything else is a regular JavaScript class that you're already familiar with. In this instance, our class is saving a state called count. And whenever we call the increment method, we increment the state and return the value. So I'm just going to run this now. But before doing that, let's take a look at the second part we have here, which is the regular workers function that you've seen a couple of times right now. So this is the fetch handler. And what the fetch handler is doing is that it's routing us to a durable object, giving a request path. So giving the same request path, we're going to be routed to the exact same durable object instance. And what this line is doing is it's figuring out the object ID based on the path we're visiting the application from, and giving that ID, which is going to be the same for the exact same URL path, we are grabbing an instance or connecting to an instance of a durable object. And over here, we are calling the increment method and returning the value. So what I'm going to do is let's give this a go. I'm going to run it. So this is npm start. All right. And we can go visit this from a browser. I'm just going to open this in the browser. And you can see that we have a state of 1. Now, if I keep refreshing, I can increment the state. And the beauty of this is that any other client on the same app path is connected to the exact same durable object instance. So if I duplicate this tab, you notice that we are on the same count. And if I increase this over here, okay, so I think that was a glitch. This is 4 right now. Let's head back. This is 5, this is 6, 7, and this should be 8, this is 9, 10, this should be 11, and this should be 12, and this should be 13. So the idea here is that any other client that is on the same route on the application will be connected to the same durable object, and they can share state, as you can see. The beauty of this is that we can persist state across restarts. So I'm just going to make a quick change to the code, and you see what that looks like. So heading back to the code, I'm just going to make a quick change. Let's zoom in. And here, I am going to make this async. All right. So what I've done here is that instead of saving the count state in memory, I am using the storage API to save the count. So what this line does is it tries to get the count from the storage. And if that does not succeed, we have a default count state of 0. And the next thing we're doing here is that we are incrementing the count and putting it back into the storage. And lastly, we're returning the count over here. So I can save this, and hopefully we have everything fine. Now, if we head back to the browser and we reload this, we should have a count of 1. Now I can keep incrementing, and of course that increments as you'd expect, But the interesting thing here is that heading back to the app and killing the server. So if we kill the server, I've killed the server right now, and we restart it. So let's run npm start. We have the server back up, and heading back to the browser and refreshing, you notice that we have that state preserved because it's stored in a persistent storage, which the durable object has access to. So this is really lovely, and there's so much you can get done with durable objects. For instance, durable objects like a worker can directly handle any HTTP request, which is awesome. Durable objects, as we'll see shortly, also has support for WebSockets, which means that you can coordinate multiple WebSocket sessions. This is great for building real-time apps like chat rooms and games. And durable objects also has support for WebGPU, which means you can build game engines inside of a durable object, and you can even run your favorite AI model inside of the durable object, which is really, really cool. And there's so much more. So please go check out the docs for all of the features that durable objects support. Durable objects is the secret sauce of the video calling app we'll be building in this series. In the next video, we'll build a WebSocket backend that serves as a server for the video calling app. So don't forget to get subscribed so that you don't miss that video when it becomes available. And let me know if you found this exciting by leaving a like on this video. I'll see you in the next one. Take care. Bye.